So I've wanted to make movies since I was 9 years old. Every summer, I would wrangle together all the neighborhood kids to make movies. I thought I was on the ground floor of the meaning of life, living my dream, doing what I was made to do. So I started a cinema club in high school. I watched movies at lunch when my friends watched girls at soccer practice, and eventually applied to USC Film School to make that dream a reality. I think God was a spiritual butler to me. You know, I'd pray for things and they'd happen. I'd pray, God, can I go to film school? That would be so awesome. And he'd be like, at least in my head, he was like, yeah, sure. You know, I exist to empower you anyway. You know, I exist for you right now to make your life great. And so my faith at the time was I believed in myself and I believed God existed for me. So on June 20th, 2011, on the bottom of the front page of the LA Times, I read a newspaper article called South Korean Pastor Tends an Unwanted Flock. And it was all about this pastor in Korea who had built what looked to me like a mailbox for abandoned babies. I mean, immediately it's like, what? You know, that shouldn't exist. I read the article 5 or 6 times, just again and again and again, and thought, what is this? Who is this man? You know, where does all his courage come from? The thought that kind of rang out in my mind was, if I don't do anything about this, everyone's gonna forget. Because that's what we do with newspaper articles. We throw them away. And so I didn't want to let myself forget. I need to reach out to this pastor. And so I sent an email out to the LA Times, and they got right back to me with all his personal contact information. I sent an email to Pastor Lee. A month later, I got an email back, and it said this: Dear Brian, this is Pastor Lee. I don't know what it means to make a documentary film about my life, but you can come live with me if you want. And so I responded, see you soon, Pastor Lee. It got real very fast. That means I can come. That means I can make the movie. That means I can go to Sundance. That means I can be famous. That means that my life will have meaning and purpose. Yeah, I thought I was a Christian before I went, because I was an American, because I wasn't a Muslim, because, you know, apple pie, the Bible, you know. I thought I was a Christian because I didn't smoke cigarettes and I watched Fox News with my mom, you know. People think they're Christians because it's decorative, it's a label. It's like, yeah, I'm a Christian, my parents are Christian, I went to youth group as a kid, or I go on Christmas and I go on Easter and stuff like that, and this is how I thought, you know. But Christianity isn't a social club, it's not a sign-up list. And I don't say that with disdain toward anybody, because most people don't know. It's like this whole deception is that we think we're Christians because we're not other things, and Christianity is just a label you put on your bumper sticker, you put on your life. Pastor Lee was different than other Christians I had met. He started talking to me about all the stuff I didn't even know pastors could talk about. He would be like, you know, yeah, so when I was in my 20s, yeah, I put my boss in the hospital for 3 weeks because I beat him up in a drunken rage. I'd be like, whoa. You know, he was like a walking, talking Coen Brothers movie. You know, he did bare knuckle boxing, right? And he was a drunkard. He aborted children with disabilities because he didn't want to have anything to do with him. Like, this guy was real. Because real people get birthed out of pain. This is what we all look for. But the reality was, Pastor Lee was a man who wasn't afraid to be known. And I was. Because there were people in my life who knew me the best, and they still had no idea what I was doing behind closed doors. They had no idea what I was feeling at night. And yet this man seemed to be able to say everything about himself, everything he struggled with, all the things he used to do, all the people he had hurt, but was free. And I wanted that. But when this pastor told me with love in his voice, he said, Jesus Christ became you on the cross so that you could become him. I was like, whoa. So you're saying Jesus became my story. He became me throughout my life so that I could live a new life. I saw Jesus Christ take my place in my story, addicted to pornography for 6 years, in really abusive relationships with girls, enraged at my parents, screaming at people on set in my life, including my little brother. And I started crying. And all I could say is, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. And that was probably the best prayer I ever prayed. My greatest mistake in life was thinking I was too good to need God's forgiveness. But what I realized that day, hearing about the cross, that Jesus Christ became me, was that Jesus had to die because sin is serious. But what I also had in that moment was I was finally known all the way through for all my junk, and God still wanted me. I never imagined what would actually happen when I would fly to South Korea, because I was going there to film a movie about saving Korean babies off the street, and I had no idea God was gonna save me. So I come back from Korea, right? I have this experience, and I finally understand the cross, and I get broken, and then I get a new life. So what I do is I pick up the phone and I call the guy who funded the first project, and I say, hey, so I was wrong. This movie isn't about Korea, it's about God. Can I go back? So I call him and he sends me more money, and we actually flew back to South Korea almost a year later to make a totally different movie. And this time it was gonna be about God's love and how he rescues broken and lost people. And then they in turn rescue broken and lost people. You don't just get saved and then it's like, great, you know, it's easy. You know, now we're walking on the yellow brick road of Christianity. My life hasn't gotten easier. It's actually gotten harder. My heart's just different, right? So I respond to things differently. The way I keep balanced is I constantly have to come back to the truth that I'm not a filmmaker. I am a son. And I keep centered by not having an orphan spirit. What I love about movies is they give us back some of what we've lost. The beginning, right? God made everything and it was good. And then we sinned. We lost a lot of stuff. We lost our relationship with him most of all, and we lost a lot of things that were good. And everything in creation got fractured. But what film can do is it can say, hey, here's a happy ending. Sin brought suffering into the world, but God's suffering is bringing it out. And that's what the movie is today. It's a living proof of a loving God. The Dropbox is the place we all belong. It's where we find ourselves bound up in the dark, totally helpless, and then pulled out through the laundry room by a father into the light.